Holy hell. What's up, Turbo?
Can you hear me or what?
No.
No.
How about now?
Yep.
Oh, all right.
I see you found your new Christmas topper.
Dude, I just had to show you that.
What a beast. What brand is that? Is that Turbonetics or?
No, VS Racing.
Oh, my goodness, dude.
$400, Chinese turbo.
What a part. What a part.
all the power you would ever need.
That looks amazing.
Yeah.
That thing was huge, dude. excuse me. Still clearing out.
How you feeling?
Better than I was. I'm still clearing out, still congested in the chest, but that's it.
So let me ask you, anytime you get even a hint of being sick, is it like, oh no, this is it. I got COVID. I'm getting it.
Kind of. I mean, you're definitely like, is this it? Is this is this my time?
Yeah.
But, dude, look what I got. CRF-150F.
Oh, nice.
New to the family.
Oh, yeah? It's yours? Yeah.
It's mine.
Oh, nice.
It's mine.
Cool.
Jackie was like, and this has never happened before, Matt, but Jackie on the couch 2 weeks ago, maybe, she was like, she looked at me and was like, I think I want to learn how to ride this year. And I was like, wait, ride what?
So you immediately go and buy one.
I was like, well, actually, you happen to know somebody who knows a little bit about motorcycles, so I'll be more than happy to help you with this.
Cool. So I'm not familiar with that one. Is it clutch and or five speed?
Yep, 5-speed electric start.
Nice.
It's an 06. I think he's the second owner of it. It's just a great bike, man. It's just a great mid-size bike that we can put around on. I was thinking, like, if she wants to learn how to ride, then this would be cool.
Yeah.
You know, to like, I don't care if she drops it. I don't care if it dumps. I don't, like, you know, it doesn't matter to me. So,
it looks clean, man. All the plastics are nice. Yeah. No, tears in the seat.
Nope. All original. The rear fender's not all bent up, you know, from someone trying to wheelie it.
No one biffed it, huh?
No one biffed it. Yeah. not yet, that is.
No, that's awesome, man. Congratulations. Yeah.
How's the build going? I haven't been able to catch up on your videos lately.
Which build?
The 2-stroke build.
Well, it's in
pieces. She's empty.
Yeah,
she's missing something.
Yeah, I tore down the engine, and the case have is out to get the drain plug retapped.
Okay.
I also sent out the cylinder. It's going to get ported and replated.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Ported for low mid gains.
Okay.
Because this is a Woods bike.
Yeah.
And the 05 stock is all mid and top, so ported, getting it replated, and then I ordered bearing seals, and I'm just waiting for the parts.
Oh, did you go with like a big kit or?
No, all OEM parts.
Okay, cool.
That's how I like to do things.
Yeah,
OEM. Oh yeah, and then crank's getting rebuilt. So yeah, the crank, the cylinder, and the case half is at Ken O'Connor Racing. He's done work for me in the past, and he does a great job. So,
they're gonna put a new crank rod, I guess, new needle bearings, then true it up and send it back.
Yeah, new rod kit, and then he slaps it back together, trues it up, and it's mint. It's a stock crank with a Pro X Japanese rod kit.
Okay.
So it's gonna be mint.
Yeah. I've heard of Pro X before. I've never used their stuff.
No, I used that rod kit in my 01 KX250, and it's been great. So
it was good. Cool, dude. It's been a while since I've talked to you.
Yeah.
We took a good 2-3 weeks off almost. They won't know that. So this episode will be next week. So this will be Thanksgiving week.
Yeah, Thanksgiving is in.
So happy Thanksgiving to everybody.
Yeah.
So yeah,
you going anywhere for Thanksgiving or?
Dude, actually, we had lots of plans, right? I'm not sure how the COVID thing is going on in your neck of the woods, but they're locking stuff back down again.
Right.
Right. And so my grandmother, who's like 82, is up from down from Maryland, and she's older, man. And so like we plan on, Jackie's family is very complicated, so I'm going to split three ways. So we plan on going to two of her side of the family's Thanksgivings, and then afterwards going to see my family's the day after Thanksgiving. But then we had to like pull it, you know, because my mom and dad were like, you know, you're going to see all these people and then you're going to come here afterwards. And it's like, I totally get it. Like they don't want, like, I would feel sick to my stomach if I had the opportunity to hurt my grandmother in any way, you know? So we had to pull the plug on seeing my families. It's just three people. It's my mom, my dad, and my grandmother. My brother and sister are in Florida, so I won't see them. So just Jackie's side. That's all we're seeing. They're about 45 minutes away in Franklin, Virginia. So it's not too far of a hike. What about you guys? You guys staying in or?
So, I mean, we usually host brunch with my wife's family. So we do like 10, 11 o'clock here. Amazing breakfast food, right?
Nice.
Brunch, whatever. And then we go to my mom's usually in the afternoon. But everyone canceled everything for the exact reasons. And
around here,
it's just same thing across this whole nation. It's just getting a little
locked down again.
There's mitigations they're calling it this time, which, and then my mom's like, you know what, I honestly don't feel like cooking anyway, so
COVID's made everybody lazy.
Yeah, because she goes all out and she's like, you know what, I'm retiring next year, let's just do it next year. I'm like, yeah, turkey sucks anyway.
No one really likes turkey.
Yeah, so
it's only good when you mash stuff into it.
Yeah, so it's all good.
Yeah, last year we did it here at our new house, and that was a lot of fun. But it's just this year's gonna be kind of a drag. It seems like I think we might do ribs instead of turkey you drinking a beer tonight?
No, dude. So,
coffee?
No.
Gin and tonic.
The vodka and kombucha.
There it is. You're bringing it to the table now.
So ice.
Okay. It looks like a old like brass cup.
It's supposed to be copper, but it's not. It's cheap.
What are they called? Kentucky mules or
Moscow mule or whatever.
Moscow mule. Yeah. Yeah, it is.
So we'll do two fingers of this stuff here.
All right.
Maybe more, maybe less. We'll see.
A little bit of booch.
Yeah, I like Tito's vodka. It's pretty good. And then this stuff right here, man.
I haven't tried it yet, man. I'm so jealous.
Watermelon Wonder.
Dude, Matt's turned into a straight mixologist over here. Excuse me, I'm going to be coughing this whole time, laughing so much. So.
And then some lime.
Gorgeous. Little mixy mix. There it is. Tito's, watermelon, kombucha, lime, and a finger. Boom.
Finger, yeah.
Well, I'm drinking. I found this in the store, and I loved it because of the way that they branded it. I'm all about branding for some reason and all that stuff. But if you look at the whole thing, it's upside down. Okay, there's the top.
Okay.
It's completely upside down. This is from Stone. So we know the record of Stone.
Yeah.
From previous videos.
It gets you messed up.
It's pretty turnt. Went Stone IPA. And on their box, it said, we made a huge mistake. And like that's just like the biggest font on there. I was like, that's awesome that they did that. And I was like, what was the mistake? But really, in the details, they were like, we just made like the most delicious IPA that we didn't think we could make. You know, But when you open the box and grab a can, all the labels are upside down. That's so funny. It's like they did make a mistake.
Oh, okay. Because at first I'm like, wait, my camera is showing. When I show stuff to you in the camera here, it's backwards for me, but not for you.
Mm-hmm.
So when you held that up, I was all messed up.
But, your camera's jacked.
Yeah. But okay.
So I have not tried this one yet.
All right.
So we'll give it a little rating. Just they call it from Stone IPA, a delicious IPA. It is gluten reduced, which is cool. Less bloat. Citrusy lemon drop hops, tropical. I'm reading upside down. Tropical El Dorado hops, and it's a 7.7, so it's pretty up there.
Well, yeah.
I like to bend my can right here, so it's just a little ND thing that I do, you know, just to keep it original.
Well, I got to match your 7.7 here.
There you go.
There.
Three finger.
I'm at 8. Finger drink.
This is really good. It's got I can see what they mean by the citrusy lemon drop hops. It's not very lemony, but it's very citrusy. So I give it 6.9 out of 10.
Okay.
It's good. It's good.
Nice.
I think midway through when it gets a little bit warmer, I'm like a little too hoppy, but it's good. Stone IPA never fails to give you a nice riney IPA.
So you can get that anywhere, or like, I know like Costco sells some Stone stuff.
So
it's pretty widespread, right?
Yeah, Stone. I feel like you can almost get anywhere. I don't know. I can't find a location on it. Stone Brewing. Richmond. They're actually local. So Richmond, Virginia. Who would have thunk?
Yeah, right by you.
I'll have to visit that. It's about maybe about 2 hours away. Cool. Well, Matt, let's get started.
Let's finally get to this, huh?
Let's do it, man. Cool.
So, dude, guess who I ran into a couple days ago?
Who?
Eric. He was from episode, I don't know. He had that KX250 axle question, and he sent
the sizing with the spacers and stuff.
Yes. So I'm at Lowe's, I'm walking out, you know, everyone's got masks on, you can't see who's who. And then he's like Matt, and I look, I'm like I don't recognize him, you know, because, you know, I've never seen him.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, it's me, Eric. And we were outside just talking for like 10-15 minutes, and he snagged a pic, so I'll give you the picture. You can put it
on. Oh, cool.
But, you know, he lives near me, and I ran into him. So that was pretty crazy that I ran into someone in public.
Yeah.
Who recognized me.
Who you've talked about. Randomly. Other viewers.
Yeah.
That's really cool, man.
Yeah.
That's really cool. I've had the privilege of when, because I work at a motorcycle shop.
Right.
People come in and they're like, they're always buying parts, or I'm up front trying to find some parts or whatever. And they're like, you're that guy off the videos. I'm like, maybe, you know, like that could be me. Like, you're the reason why I'm here buying parts. And it's always a cool feeling to be like,
nice.
That's me. Yeah, it's cool.
So it's happened to you too, huh?
Nice. It's happened. What's going on, everybody? Cody from Motorcycle MD coming at you with my buddy, Matt, from How to Motorcycle Repair for episode 15 of the Broken Moto Show. Welcome, new and old people who have been viewing this. We have a couple episodes now, so those of have stuck around, thank you. And what we do is pretty much try to go through emails that we have collaborated on as far as an email goes, and we want to talk about the problems that you guys have with your bikes. So we ask you guys to send in emails about or videos or pictures of your bike to a specific email. Matt, what is that email?
AskBrokenMoto@gmail.com.
That's it. What do we require?
So put the year, make, and model in the description. No, the subject. And then in the description, just give us your name, location, and be very descriptive on the problem that you're having. Mileage.
Yeah.
Pictures and videos are a plus. And one thing I noticed with you guys submitting videos is you guys don't talk. You kind of just, yeah, you know, like, hey, say a few words, explain what we're looking at. I think
yeah,
that's like free to put that in there.
Yeah, for sure.
Don't be afraid to talk.
So. Don't be afraid to talk. We love to hear your guys' input on what you think it is, and, you know, help us kind of direct us into the video. Even if you have a runnability issue, post pictures of something that you may not think is important, like the spark plugs. It's very important. I mean, it's very easy to pop them out, snap a shot, and then we have some more stuff to go off of. That's always helpful. Matt, thank you for the information. Dude, this bug.
Yeah, I see that.
Did you see the bug?
I did. It's like a little speck, like this little guy.
Jesus. Flying around. All right. Episode 15, question one. Let's dive in. So this one's an old one from, Yeah.
It's a follow-up.
Okay, yeah. Follow-up. So this is from episode. Oh, cool. You put the, dude.
You want me to get this one while you chase that bug?
Yeah.
All right. So this is a follow-up from Brett. His dad's 82 CB900C. He originally gave us some information on episode 11. Okay, gents, I appreciate the answers. I wanted to share some data. I finally got the gas cap off. So yeah, he had the lock or frozen gas cap.
Yeah.
And I rebuilt the carbs with all new diaphragms, jets, and needles. Chinese in parentheses. I did the compression testing earlier today, and here are the results. For the compression with added oil cycles, I used about a teaspoon of Rotella T6 heavy duty diesel oil because that's all I had. I don't think it matters. These compression differences make me think that I don't need to rebuild the top end again. Thoughts? Question mark. I think my compression numbers look fairly good, but I'm concerned about the jump from no top end oil on top of the piston to having oil on the top of the piston. What do you guys think? I see no reason here to crack the head gasket. All right, so he put together this chart. Can you see that all right?
I might be able to maybe put it in a video. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, maybe we can.
Thanks for showing it. Yeah.
So get a good look at that. All right, so one thing, though, on this chart, he has one comp cycle, one compression cycle, five compression cycles, 10 compression cycles. I don't know if that's what he means by – what do you think he means by that? How many cranks? So
I think that you picked out immediately what I picked out, and that is him doing like a no, 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 and then a five compression cycle, no, 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 and then 10. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When all compression tests, as per the book, should be done throttle wide open, and you go until the numbers stop reaching. Yes. Like, so that's just the way you do it.
So what's going to happen when you're doing it is you're going to get a big jump in the beginning, then a smaller jump, smaller, smaller, and then it's going to just stop.
Right.
Then you're done.
Then you're done. That's when you stop.
You want the maximum number.
And it looked like his was at around 10 compression cycles is what he's calling it. Yeah. So the 1 and 5 is not needed because that's not good information because right. you're going to get those numbers. You're going to get those low numbers that you got.
Sure. So let's ignore all that and just go right to, you know, the 10 comp cycles, which is, yep. So I guess with no oil, he got 155, 155, 135, 150.
Yep.
Okay. And then he added oil and he got 190, 180, 180, 170. Okay.
Yeah. which is a given.
Yeah.
So if you add oil, the numbers will jump dramatically. Yeah.
So the oil, what it does is it creates a temporary seal. No blow by, no air pissing past the rings, and you mm-hmm. get higher numbers. First off, your numbers dry are pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they did jump up with oil. But again, this is a bike that's been sitting for a long time.
Yeah.
This thing needs to be run. Right. I would get this thing running, tuned, go run it.
Nice and hot, yeah.
Run it hard. And then do the compression test hot. And I think you'll be pleased with the numbers you'll get.
Yeah.
With that.
I think the stock numbers like from 150 to 190 is like really, really good. Like if you have like 160 to 190, you have a new motor.
Yeah.
Anything below that, you're right in the market for like what you would expect. 140 to 160 is really good on an old bike. As soon as you start dropping into like the 100 to 130 range, you should be a little bit more concerned.
Yeah.
I feel like 135, the bike will run all day long like that. It may not get the best gas mileage, but it will run all day long.
Yeah. So to answer his question, man, I would just focus on getting it tuned, streetable, ride it. Don't open the engine.
Yeah, don't. No need.
And
135 cylinder, so like cylinder three, there may be trouble in there, but it's not worth cracking open.
Yeah. And I mean, with it sitting, who knows what's, if there's a sticky ring or whatever.
Absolutely.
It might free up.
Absolutely.
Yeah, dude.
Hondas have a great way of fixing themselves after you ride them.
there's more. My dad did not use a KBS product to seal the tank. That was my mistake. Attached are some before and after pictures of the tank and the stuff I removed. So yeah, he had a nasty looking tank and then he had an after. It looked really clean. So
it looked amazing.
Yeah. I was like, wow.
I was impressed.
I don't need to get mine that clean. So, yeah,
heck
that
no.
That was good.
Yeah.
And then a steed is the ST1300 in pick number 5. Beer is coming your way. Keep up the show. Thanks, Brett.
Ooh.
Nice. Thanks, Brett.
Thanks, Brett. So yeah, don't crack the motor.
Nope.
That's all we got to say about that.
And the Chinese carb parts, well, that's going to be a question mark. So
it will be. But he may be able to get it to run off of it. We don't know. But if you have problems, well, you've been warned. Sweet. So, Matt, I think we got some donations this year or this week. Last week?
Yeah, we did. Yes, we did. So, who do we have here?
So, we have a beer fund that you guys can donate to. I think I got it. I didn't get it. Dang it.
I could see that. You totally missed.
So we have a beer fund that you can donate to. And all that does is we like to talk about beers that we drink or mixed drinks that we like to make up to mix while we go through the questions that we have with you guys. And it's a way that you can support us. You know, we spend time doing these videos. We edit them. Me and Matt share the edits. Takes a while. I'll probably spend most of the day tomorrow getting this video up for you guys. So those of you who have supported us, thank you. Those of you who haven't, kick rocks. You know, no, I'm just kidding. This is for the free world. So we have 3 donations. Sound them out, Matt.
All right. So first up, we have Justo again.
Justo. he never fails, dude. Always there for us.
Awesome, man. Thank you so much. And then we have Jeff and then Matthew.
So Matthew. Jeff,
yeah.
Justo, and Matt, Matthew. Thank you for the beer. Cheers. Thank you for the drinks. Cheers. Tink. We appreciate you guys seeing the value in this. Bastard. I think I got it. We'll see. All right. So on to question number 2. 99 Yamaha WR400F low idle and bog issues. Hey, guys. My name is Matt, and I am in Pismo Beach, California area. Recently, I picked up a classic thumper. Am I on the right question?
Yes.
Yeah. Recently, I picked up a classic thumper to tinker with and want to get it rocking like new again. I rebuilt the top end to stock specs, sleeved, machined, and honed cylinder, new OEM rings and piston. I replaced the aftermarket auto decompression exhaust cam with the stock exhaust cam because it wasn't working. I don't mind using the decompression lever when needed. Shim to adjust valves at OEM setting, verified proper timing at top dead center, replaced the air filter, all fluids, and checked for leaks. Finished assembling the bike, and it started up on the second kick. As I was going through the break-in process, it would not idle and has low-end bog popping and just does not run smooth until you roll back the throttle. So low RPM bogging, so right off So I then went to the car. Here is where my project has stopped. I did a basic rebuild kit, clean and replace, no improvement. Removed again, realized that that Kian has an accelerator pump. The linkage was moving slowly to react to throttle pull. So I checked and little to no fuel was coming out of the nozzle in the body. At that point, I disassembled the midsection to get it cleared out. This all went great until I noticed someone had not replaced the main body O-ring and used JB Weld along with some other kind of silicone sealant. Big, big bummer. These parts are no longer individually available for the 9899 model. Big bummer because now I can't put an O-ring even if I find one because of the JB Weld. A new Kian carb is $960. Not an option. An eBay aftermarket carb that fits perfectly is $310. Maybe an option. Do you feel I can put back together using MotoSeal by Permatex? It's good for gas and high heat gaskets. Any advice to help me get rolling would be very appreciated. You guys are great, and thanks for your consideration, Matt. So we had the picture for this, right? I think I saw it. I didn't see where the JB Weld was.
It just looked like gray
silicone,
non-hardening, yeah. Honda Bond 4,
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah,
but then again, JB Weld is gray as well. So
it is gray,
but it's a little darker. That looked a little light.
Yeah, I really zoomed in on it, and I was like. Okay. See any JB Weld here?
Yeah,
but someone's been in there and they dicked it up good.
Yeah,
because that's not an area you want silicone, nor should you ever be using silicone on your carburetors, guys.
No, it's gonna not last.
Right.
So
never. I don't care what O-ring set you buy, whatever. Never silicone your gaskets because you don't need to on your carburetor if it's this freaking bug, Matt. It's got to go.
Hey, dude. What do you use to hold gaskets in place for assembly?
So I have a Permatex that is it's a gasket. It's called a gasket dressing gasket dressing. It's from Permatex, and it's specifically designed to be around gas. It's like purple. Okay. Honda also has a. It's kind of weird, but it's called a hand, and they have a hand grip cement.
Okay.
And lo and behold, it's garbage for hand grips. It does not work on hand grips. Okay. It's bad. It never dries. The hand grips, you can twist them, but it's a hand grip cement. They also sell that, but Permatex, this is something that you can get from auto parts store or whatever. It's from Permatex. It's purple. The liquid coming out of it. I'll post a picture of it or a link or whatever, but it's for gas and it's called a gasket dressing. And that's what I use. It works great.
It's super tacky. Just glues it in place.
And it never hardens.
Okay.
It never hardens.
So, I mean, I've used dabs of grease.
Yeah. Yep.
Or
bingo.
Petroleum jelly. I mean, like very little and like,
yeah,
get it in there and wipe it. So it doesn't, make a mess.
Yeah, just like all four corners, boom.
Yep. Yeah, whatever it takes.
Done. Yep.
I was just curious about that. But do you deal with these FCR carbs a lot?
So the CR flat slide is what we're talking about, or in Honda terms, it's the CR. Yeah, I've dealt with them. I've never removed that mid body ever.
Yeah, neither have I.
They sell kits for them. Like you can buy the gasket kits for them all day long. I've never had to remove them.
Yeah. So, that's one of his questions. It looks like he can't find that, but, they're all the same, the FCR carbs. And if you're not going to see it in the fish or fishy.
Correct. No.
So here, go on eBay and right here, mid body gasket, Kian FCR.
Look at that. Matt delivers. So Matt delivers.
So that's $30 with the screws. And, this guy is called, what's the seller's name here? God damn it, I had it. Oh, Frank MX parts. And I know this guy. He's a Keihan dealer. And I know because I had to, he sells these, which is for the PWK Keihans.
Okay.
For the two-stroke, like behind me.
Yeah.
For the KX. So I had to replace that, or I replaced it because I was, you know, freaking paranoid.
Right.
So anyway, what this guy should do is clean up the JB Weld, the gasket material, get that all out of there.
Yep.
All of it. Get that new gasket that you can find on eBay. So the low end bog and the popping is usually all accelerator pump.
Yeah.
And I think he mentioned here that there was little to no fuel coming out of that nozzle.
Mm-hmm. That's where his trouble is.
Yes.
Sure.
And the linkage was moving slow to react. So I have a good video on accelerator pump timing.
Oh, cool.
Carburetor. So
cool.
What you need to do is get this thing idling because the idle screw will set the slide. The throttle wheel has a cam that will lift and push the plunger for the diaphragm. And at idle, there should be minimal play between that cam. So as soon as you start opening it, that is going to start activating the accelerator pumps to give you the earliest shot possible.
Yeah.
If you have the screw too advanced, it will push the plunger down and effectively give you no volume for squirt.
Hmm.
If you have it retarded, you have so much play that the slide opens, you don't get the fuel squirt, and it'll pop because it's a lean pop or whatever.
Real bog.
Yeah, bog, lean pop, whatever.
Yeah.
All of the above. So it's very critical to get that down.
And very sensitive.
Yeah.
Make sure that your RPM is set right too. I found that high compression bikes or whatever, if you don't have the RPM set high enough, you'll never get it right.
Yeah. So it's like what, 1800 to 2200.
Yeah, it's pretty high. It's higher than what your ear wants to hear.
Yep. And of course, having the fuel screw set up properly is very critical on these bikes and carbs. Cause dude, have you ever had one of these where the fuel screw's out of whack? It just total.
It runs like dirt.
They're stubborn. You're lucky if it'll even start.
Absolutely. You'll kick it for days. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. They're very sensitive. They're very sensitive. Yeah, for sure. But kudos to this guy for listening to his motor run after he rebuilt it. You know, happy clap for him because there's not too many people get to do that.
Yeah. Nice job, man. And and he lives in Pismo Beach. So
is that cool or is that bad?
That's awesome, man. I mean,
is it?
I don't know. I mean,
I've never been to California.
I lived in California for a year and a half in Studio City. I forget where Pismo is. I think Orange County, right? I don't know. Anyway, California's pretty awesome. Interesting.
Yeah.
But, you know. Anyway.
Well, kudos to him for living in California.
but anyway, some other things.
Dude, oh, there is.
I remember this bike, or at least the 426F, when I was working at a dealer in 99. And, dude, I sprained my goddamn ankle trying to start one of these because I didn't have the decompression in I didn't have it in the right spot.
Yeah.
Went to kick it and just, dude. I weighed like, oh man, I was probably like 130, 140 pounds of things. Just like, boop, see you later, dude. You know,
that happened to me on an XR 600R. Honda had an XR, like it was in the '80s, XR 600R, dude. And it was a brute to start.
Yeah.
A brute. And Dave's like, you're going to hurt your ankle. I'm like, I got it. You know, I got this.
Yeah.
I'm outside starting. And he's like, just let me pull you on the four wheeler. And I'm like, no, I'm like, this bike's meant to be kicked. And it just wrecks your shin.
Oh my God.
Wrecks
dude.
Your ankle if it kicks. Oh,
I don't ever want to try starting one of those again. Like, I mean, thank God they came out with that auto decompression mechanism for every other bike. I mean, holy shit. And then I don't know if it was this one, but the hot start. Okay. It had the choke and then it had the red knob for the hot start.
Mm-hmm.
You remember that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So then they moved the hot start up on the lever, but
up on the lever. Yeah.
I'm like, what the hell are all these knobs? You know, I'm like, you know,
like two on the carb, one on the top of the handlebars.
Yeah, I'm just like, Jesus Christ.
yeah, finger in the whole way you're trying to start it.
But anyway, Matt, when you get this thing up and running, fine-tuning the fuel screw and the pilot jet, I have a lot of videos on that. And then I also have a lot of videos on the leak jet. Accelerator pump timing.
That's cool.
O-ring mod. So the O-ring mod, are you familiar with that?
Nope.
So you slip an O-ring over on the, where the timing screw is. So it couples the wheel and that. So it brings the cam around faster and it gives you a stronger squirt.
The O-ring goes where?
So you know the throttle wheel?
Yep.
And then there's the timing screw?
Yes.
Those are not coupled.
Okay.
There's usually a spring in the back.
Yeah.
But if you slip an O-ring, a number 78 O-ring from the hardware store, it kind of couples those together, so it brings it around faster.
Interesting. Okay.
So it's forcing the lever down, the push rod down faster,
yeah,
for the diaphragm to squirt fuel into the
car. Very interesting. I've never heard of that ever.
So there's you're familiar with JD jetting?
Nope.
Okay, they do a lot of jet kits for off-road bikes and they have different O-rings in their kits. They have different thicknesses of O-rings to give it more stretch or less stretch,
and
you can alter the pump shot.
Very interesting.
Yeah, and a lot of people in the have also safety wired that stuff.
Okay.
However, that's not a good idea because then that's a rigid connection.
Mm-hmm.
The O-ring is like, you know,
pliable.
Yeah.
Wow, dude, I've never heard of any of this side. I mean, we don't deal with too much dirt. Right. In Norfolk. So this is news to me. And this is all to solve the reaction of how fast the accelerator pump gets functioned.
Yeah. And dude, there's so much more to this goddamn accelerator pump. Okay, you got the leak jet. Are you familiar with that in the bottom of the bowl of the carburetor?
If you pointed it out to me, I probably would.
So this is your bowl. It's in the very bottom. So what it is it's a bleed. And what happens is when you roll the throttle slowly, it bleeds fuel back into the bowl because you don't need a pump shot when you're just rolling
slowly. Rolling it on, yeah.
But when you whack it really fast, you need
that
fuel. So the leak jet controls how much
bleeds
back into the bowl.
Yeah.
So there's actually different leak jets. Like, these bikes usually come with very large leak jets, like 90, 70, 80, which is a big hole. So it's going to bleed a lot back to the bowl and less into the motor. What you can do is reduce that size. For 250Fs, I usually do a 45.
So halving it.
So that's a smaller hole.
Yeah.
And it bleeds less back into the bowl and more into the motor. Because the 250Fs are known to be lean from the factory.
Okay.
Okay.
This is for what? Kawasaki, Suzuki, or? Doesn't matter.
All the 250Fs are.
Okay.
I found that they're lean.
Very interesting.
KTMs do not have leak jets. They're blocked off, some of them.
Huh?
So that's, it just depends.
Yeah.
They all use the FCR carbs, but they set them up differently.
Yeah.
All right, am I boring you?
No. You actually teach me something new, so I'm very intrigued.
Okay, and then there's another thing. You know the bottom of the diaphragm, there's a rivet or a little tit on there on the bottom.
Yeah.
Okay. Some of them have big ones.
Ooh,
okay.
Yeah.
Tits and little tits. Okay.
Mm. Which one do you want?
It depends on the situation.
Keep us on track.
Some Hondas, like, it's hard to know what's going on because some bikes are lean from the factory and some are rich from the factory.
Yeah.
Some of them are, the duration of the shot is too long and some of them are too short. There's so many goddamn little things you can do this thing. But anyway.
But I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah.
So Honda's,
it's like a little shelf on top of the diaphragm that you can, they're like larger ones and smaller ones to help the rod contact the diaphragm sooner or later.
Actually, this tit is a stop. So imagine if the rod was pushing it down.
Yep.
It's on the bottom of the diaphragm. It's a physical hard stop.
Okay, it's a stop. Okay, got it.
So imagine if it was really tall. Well, all of a sudden your volume of squirt is
reduced.
And if you
got it,
if you have a small rivet, it pushes it down further. You're gonna
get more volume.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay.
So, how you determine if you have a lean or rich pump shot is, well, turn the choke on.
Okay.
If it gets better, you need more fuel. If it was rich, I guess it would get worse, right?
Just blah, die out.
Yeah. I mean, I've jetted some KTMs and I bought the JD jet kits because they come with a little spacer that you install to increase the rivet length to reduce the volume on that particular model. And it, you know, dude, there's so many things that play a factor.
There is. Obviously. And I've never even dealt with that, but it makes total sense because I've tried adjusting them, you know, as much as I can. And I pretty much end up jumping the RPM up, you know, because that will ultimately solve it. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you can go richer on the pilot, richer on the fuel screw. That helps.
I never mess with bleed jets.
So, dude, I got a video. My brother sold it, an 06 YZ250F. I get on it. I do a before, and I'm rolling slow, and I whack the throttle. It's just like, right?
Yeah.
I do the leak jet, pilot jet fuel screw mod, and the O-ring, and then you hammer it, and the thing will loop out.
Wow.
I mean, it's just like instant response.
No, that's cool. That's really cool.
That's what you want. You want to biff that bike.
Yeah, you want to biff
whenever
it,
you dude. Want.
Dump it. Runs on the rocks.
Sorry I talked a lot about that.
No, dude, honestly, Matt, you taught me something new, man, and that's really cool. That's really cool. Well, hopefully the audience gets to experience that as much as I did because I was intrigued.
Oh, and one more thing, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
So Rocky Mountain ATV sells individual leak jets.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but if you were working on a Honda and you looked in the carburetor fish and you saw the leak jet and it was a 90 and they give you the Honda part number, the last three would be like -090
or four numbers, yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah,
then just the part number, change it to -045 or whatever. If you want 45 leak jet,
okay,
you can probably search just by part number, right?
Yeah.
And then it's available. So if you ever want to play, they'll never list it as an option in the carb fish.
Interesting.
So, but if you play, you know how to play around the numbers to get the jet you want, right?
You can't. Either it's going to show up as something that's real or it's not.
Right. Sometimes you get lucky. Sometimes you don't.
Mm-hmm.
So just
interesting
information
okay.
for you.
I know of Rocky Mountain too. So
yeah, but
they sell kits.
They sell just the individual jet. It's like $799 each, yeah. And you're good.
Good info. Good info.
All right. All right. Well, I know you did the last one, and I totally just like stole it from you.
No, you didn't steal anything, man. This is awesome. This is like I learned stuff. I'm excited to like try this on some of the bikes that I work on. So thank you.
Question three.
Let's hit it.
Picks included.
Mm.
Hi guys, I follow your channel and was very glad to see you done this episodes together. I have a camshaft question. I bought an 86 Yamaha FCX 700 SC 3 years ago. He was poorly maintained and sitting for some 5-6 years. No need to tell you, it was a lot of work. When I was check engine valves, only 2 of 20 was in spec. The other ones were too tight. I sent you pictures and attachments so you can see how the camshaft looks. As I can tell, I have oil in my engine head. Half screw for checking oil pressure and engine head.
Okay.
Question is the camshaft gone? Can it be repaired? New ones are 900 euro.
Yeah.
Repair, so out of my budget. Engine is running great. No pops, no problems. Runs great. And I made some 5,000 kilometers since I took this photo. I have ticking noise, but think it's because I set the valves on the loose side. Ticking valves are happy valves, I guess. Slappy valves are happy valves, right? Thanks in advance and keep up the great work you do to our community. I, Vika, it's Slavic version of Johnny.
Wow. Who would have thought?
Yeah. that's not even close.
Not even close at all.
I would have never guessed that.
Learn something new every day. So the camshaft photos, I'll probably post them now or while you were talking. I think it looks fine. I mean, the areas that the lobes look great. The entire camshaft lobe, which is the big wear part, looks great. The part he's concerned about is the camshaft, I guess what we call the bearing section. Yeah,
the journal.
The journal on the section, which is just, it's just metal on metal. I mean, there is some oil clearance there, but it's metal on metal. There's no, you know, plain bearing there or, you know, brass bearing or ball bearing. There's nothing there. It's just metal on metal. And it's designed to wear. And the way that his pictures looked, it looked like normal wear. I mean, when we're looking for wear, heavy wear on camshafts, we're looking for something that you can either like, let's say we have a flat surface, right? This is the flat surface, and it's encased in a bearing sleeve, right? So the camshaft's turning inside of this sleeve. That surface, we're looking for like that, you know? So when you can like feel a difference, like a ramp inside because it's heavily worn, or we're looking for anything that's like super heavily grooved that you can feel with your fingernails. And from the pictures that I saw, Matt, it looked like it was normal wear. It looked like if he was experiencing any heavy wear issues, camshaft noise usually comes at high RPM. So the camshaft's like spinning, obviously twice as fast as the crankshaft, and it's starting to rock like this. It's like floating. I've seen like slow-mo pictures of like old camshafts running, and like they're doing this like this crazy wave thing, and that can cause a ticking or almost like a knock in the top end, which is kind of rare to hear. And it looks normal to me. I mean, even the cam caps that he showed looked like they were just, you know, there was some side wear from probably when they were machined. I don't know.
So
what do you think?
Well, okay. The cams, when you look at the pics, you're like, whoa, that looks kind of bad, right?
Right. I can see where he's coming from.
However, that is hardened steel.
Yeah.
And then the camshaft bridge cap, whatever you want to call it, is aluminum, which is super soft.
Mm-hmm.
And those look mint.
Yeah, they do. They look great.
Those would be the first to go.
Yeah. You would see it mainly on the head section.
Yeah, because it's the chain's pulling it down.
Right? Exactly.
So given that the aluminum looks great, it's all good, man.
Send it.
Yeah. I mean, and what happens when that area gets all screwy? The aluminum starts to
big time
go big time,
because right? The cam chest harder.
Right. That's not happening here. So,
and then you'll see like discoloration from like heat.
Yeah.
And that kind of, like, honestly, I understand, Johnny, where you're coming from and your reason to question it. And it's very wise of you, but, don't worry about it, man. You're good. You're good.
I'd run it.
Why not? I've seen way worse. I'll post pictures of it. Way worse. Cool. That was easy.
Awesome. Yeah.
Question four. Yeah, I did not look at this one, Matt, so hopefully you have the answer, okay? I apologize for asking this on the channel. My question is about the actual hole size of the 06 Honda CRF50 pilot jet. Forums are all over the place, but some seem to maybe be correct on 0.02. So he's on standard. So 12 thousandths. You seem to be the few who really know their shit. So I trust what you guys say. Big mistake. Thank you for all your videos and help and advice. Take care, Brian. So all I can do is just like, for some reason, I can't log into my Honda account from home, which is really weird. To look at like actual Honda parts fishes. So I would just look at Partzilla and then it would tell me what the size of the jet is.
Like diameter?
It would just say, you know, number 32.
Oh yeah.
And what I've measured out for that stuff to be is 0.32
millimeters.
Right. And it's a very tight 0.32. So the things what you guys have to realize, which I share in my carb workshops, Matt, on the Inner Circle. What's that? Oh, look at that. 0.32. Was there a 32 jet?
Point 32. Well, I don't know if that's the jet size.
Oh, okay.
Well, let's just go with it because it's 12 and a half thousandths. So there you go.
That's it right there, dude. 12 thousandths. So there's different fittings, right? So there's like push fit, press fit, you know, all that stuff.
Yeah.
So when you're dealing with all these different fittings, you're literally talking about the clearance between this surface on the hole and then whatever's going into it. So there are different surfaces for that, and they all relate to different applications, like when bearings go into cases or when rockers have pivots that they sit on, you know, like there's a number of different. So the point, what I measure jets at in millimeters, which is the correct measurement on the US, is when you're measuring like 0.32 millimeters, because they're saying it's a number 32 jet, or it's a number 42 jet, number 45. I measure that in 0.45, 0.32, 0.30, whatever. And it's very, very tight. When you have a drill bit, let's say that size, it's going to be very tight. And so, but it's very close. I mean, it's like, it's very close. It's literally what it is. It has to be.
No, I guess, why is he at? Why is he asking this question?
I don't know.
Okay. But anyway, so here's a story. I was working on a 90cc Polaris. Okay. I'm saying 90cc just because this is a 50cc.
Yeah.
The pilot jet was totally plugged, and I actually had to poke a pin through the pilot jet because I could not clean it any other
way. Yeah.
And we have pin gauges Yep. I was able to get pin gauges, and the pin gauge that went through that one was like 15 thou or so.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, that's a larger engine, larger pilot jet. But my point is, 12,000 seems right. You said
yeah.
You said a 32 pilot, which is
that sounds common.
And we did the math, and we got 12,500. So yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah, it sounds good. Moving on. Parts fish it, dude. Parts fish it. It's going to tell you. Like, I don't know why people are using standard numbers to. Dude, I don't know.
I can't think in millimeters.
I can't. Honest. I'm really?
You
wait,
can't.
Wait. You wait, can't. Time out. That's all I think about, dude. Do you torque things in foot pounds or newton meters?
Inch pounds and foot pounds.
Okay, see, I'm different, man. Yeah. I'm a different breed because I only trust newton meters.
Here's the shitty thing, dude. I went to college for engineering. Everything is metric. Everything.
Okay.
We never talked SAE or anything. Good. Dude, it makes no goddamn sense. The US
standard
measuring system.
Yeah. No,
it's stupid. It is stupid. Dude, metric system off the base 10.
Yeah.
Whatever. It makes total sense. And then you get out in the real world and everything's inches and
yep.
It's stupid, dude. I wish we were metric here.
I wish we were too. It sounded like what you were saying is that you're pro standard, which would be like 3/8, 9/16, 5/8, 1/2.
No, I mean, no, I like metric.
Yeah, dude,
but the problem is, like, that's not reality here.
It's not reality.
When you're doing
unless you're working at a Honda dealership where everything's 10s, 12s, 14s, and 17s.
But even in engineering, everything was actually, it was both. It sucked. That's what made it even worse. Like, I worked for some companies based in the US. We went with SAE stuff.
Yeah.
And then we had like Canadian customers and metric customers, and we had to dual dimension. Dude, ooh. It just was stupid, dude. It was crazy. Anyway.
Metric's the way to go, Matt. Let's change the world. One YouTube video at a time.
It is.
Never gonna happen. Never gonna happen.
No,
it's gonna stay standard, man. Well, that's it, man. I think that was the end of the questions.
Well, yeah, it was definitely an hour or more. So yeah, okay. We'll stop there.
Pretty common. So guys, thank you for submitting your questions to the Broken Motor Show. Again, my name is Matt. I mean,
seven stone.
That's a first. That's a first. My name is Cody. From Motorcycle MD, Matt from Mouth to Motorcycle Repair. But I will add for you guys to follow me on Instagram. If you want more help on your bike and you want more personal help with me, I have an Inner Circle membership that I offer on the website. And I will also add, Matt, that all of the shirts and all of the products that I sell on the website will be going on sale Black Friday. I'm gonna do probably up to like a 40% off.
Wow.
On everything. So I will add that to this video. Do you have anything to plug?
Do you have any hoodies on sale?
I do. I have no hoodies. All I have is t-shirts.
Oh, you live in a warm climate.
I do.
Everyone needs hoodies right now, dude.
I was thinking about it next round.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Do I anything have anything plug? To plug? Yeah, dude, yeah. I got two builds going on. I got this 05 KX250 and I got a turbo V8 Chevelle.
Show them that turbo one more time, Matt.
Okay, let me get it.
One more time. A bazinga. Bazinga, you can chop salad in that thing and feed it to your
So this thing is good for up to 750 horsepower max.
Oh my goodness.
Which I'm not going to go near that because I'll shit my pants. But this is crazy, dude.
It looks gorgeous, man. You should eat cereal out of it.
I've always wanted one.
That is really cool, man. I'm really excited for you. Maybe one day you'll make a trip to like to my side with that car and we'll ride in it, dude.
Yeah.
Imagine that.
I think I can.
Rogamoto show from one location.
I'll have to put a hitch on there.
Yeah. It's true. We got to ride.
Trailer, tow some motorcycles around.
That'd be cool, man.
Yeah.
Thank you guys so much for checking this out. Again, if you want to support us, support the channel or support our channels, you can support us through a beer fund that we offer in the description. Anything that we talked about, links, products, videos that we may offer will be in the description below that you can find it if it's not like highlighted up in the top or bottom of this video. So thank you guys so much for checking this out. We'll see you guys next time. Right, Matt?
That's right.
That's right.
And that email is, wait, we already gave him the email. AskBrokenMoto@gmail.com.
There it is again.
Yeah.
That's all you need.
All right. I'm Cody. See ya.
I'm Matt. Later.